For most people in Cambodia, medical treatment is unobtainable.
It's a challenge every day to decide, should we do this patient, what should we do?
We follow a small surgical team trying to save the lives of the poorest and most desperate in Phnom Penh.
How do you handle cases like this?
Well, it's very difficult. Grit your teeth and keep going.
On BBC World News at these times.
Now on BBC World News, Cambodia Surgical Ward follows an Anglo-American Khmer team trying to save lives in Phnom Penh's only free surgical centre. The programme contains scenes of medical surgery.
OK, in the other set, there's a big, wide osteotom, a 1.5 inch or something, in one of the sets. Could we get it out today? My God, this is getting look like the Atlanta railway station on Gone with the Wind. Well, you turn up in the morning and it looks like a mob scene and something out of Gandhi, right? And you think, how are we going to get through all this work? What on earth is going on? And so it's quite a deal.
The daily rounds at the Children's Surgical Centre in Phnom Penh.
Is it any better? Does he feel better now? But it's about a four-month-old baby, so she's...
Its founder, Dr. Jim Golagly. In impoverished Cambodia, surgical treatment for most people is unattainable. Travelling from every part of the country, if they can reach this treatment centre, they have a chance of an operation, a new start, a new life.
It wasn't a normal injection, and on this side she can bend a knee, but a kneecap, instead of being over here, is over here. There's a kneecap, and it should be sitting on here, right?
So in bed after bed, a challenging range of surgical cases. This is a nation still trying to rebuild a medical system a generation after the murderous rule of the Khmer Rouge.
She couldn't bend at all. She had it like that. She couldn't bend it, and that's obviously a big problem in a country like this, where you squat to go to the toilet.
Cases that often have gone untreated for months or even years.
So we're pretty happy with all this. We're doing neglected disease, really, that nobody's really done it. And that's basically what you're going to see all around here.
Dr. Jim Golagly, an Englishman with Irish roots, studied medicine at Trinity College Dublin and then began roaming the world. After Australia and South Africa, he came to the US, where he began a career as an orthopaedic surgeon in Alaska. That's where he may still have been today, had it not been for the chance of a quick relief mission in Cambodia. A quick mission that has turned into almost a 20-year commitment.
What happened was that I came here in 1992-93 with the American Red Cross for 6 months and really thought that this was the most destitute place I'd ever seen. And a couple of years later, some of the people who I'd met at that time asked me to come back and set up an organization for landmine victims who'd had the landmine in their hand when it went off. So the people putting it down or picking it up, or sometimes just kids picking it up. So we came back in 1998 and started to do that. But I knew from my time before that there was a huge dearth of surgery and there are a lot of crippled kids around. And so I came back with the idea that we'd start the program for landmine injuries, but we'd do whatever we could when we came along. And then as soon as we started, the polio kids came in and everybody came in. So we ended up really doing whatever showed up.
On the operating table this afternoon, a young man, Nong Sak Na. Like so many, he has a condition that has gone untreated for years, now requiring major surgery.
What we're just going to do is a boy with some great big tumours on the back of his shoulder. They're bony tumours, and they interfere with the function of his shoulder, and he looks terrible, so he wants us to take them off. The problem is they're very big, and the access to them is going to be difficult, and so it's going to be a bit of a difficult operation. It's certainly not something that we do commonly, a big one like this. And he's got them on his scapula and on the back of his humerus, and I'm anticipating a little bit of trouble. You can't. You're going to get bag the nerve somehow, right? Yeah, I think that we're going to have to reflect it here. So I think the deltoid...
In a country of such primitive medical resources, as news of the centre has spread, it has found itself dealing with more and more complicated cases from people with nowhere else to go.
To make, right? I mean, you know, basically the deal is here, you can't just wait for another specialist to come along, because you're the specialist right now. It's a big problem, right? No, it's a big problem, right? Okay, let's stop the bleeding as we go. All right, go on right down through the fat, right down to the muscle. Let's, yeah. We didn't have general anesthesia at first, right? So we had to start off with things that you could only do under local anesthesia, and then as we got more staff and got more skilled, things started building, and then we've learned to do more and more. And so as time goes on, we're getting into a little bit of a problem that we're becoming a sort of tertiary referral center for Cambodia instead of doing the sort of bread and butter stuff that we started off doing.
Right.
You're getting into the bottom, that's teres minors and teres major. You should be really dividing this down here so that you can strip it forward if you need to. Right, but there it is.
Assisting in the operation, one of the Khmer surgeons employed at the centre, Dr. Soom Ratta.
Going free. Right, okay, yeah. Well, there's a big nerve that comes out here that gets the big muscle, your deltoid muscle, that makes your deltoid muscle work. And if we cut that nerve, and the nerve's somewhere in this tumour, got to be somewhere, but the tumour's distorted everything so much that we don't know where it is.
I mean, it's a challenge every day, right, to decide, are you doing the right thing? Should we do this patient? What should we do? And I think that it's a bit wearing. You need a break now and again. And and then you just got to wing it and have a go.
The aim is for the local team eventually to become proficient in the kind of surgery Cambodia needs.
So you're going to need an incise up here, right? Right, and then, which muscle is it, number one? Which muscle is it? I think, look, we've got to start chiseling it off. Okay, give me that one, right. Okay, I'll start at this end, and then you can start at that end.
Working from both directions with chisels, eventually the largest of the tumours comes free.
Big swab, here.
It's a boy,
yes. And over there. This is the tumours that came out of his back. There's bits and pieces as well. And the problem is, if this is a sarcoma, which I think there's a possibility that it is, then this is not good for him. Now, give me the bone cutters and the bone biters.
There are three tables in this one operating room,
and,
right.
And can they all be working at the same time sometimes?
And most of the time they are all working at the same time. It's just lunchtime now. What we've tried to do is keep this as a Khmer operation. So we've got about 16 doctors on the staff, and the idea would be that we are training them all the time to get better, do better surgery, be more accurate diagnosticians, decide the right things, how to do it, and they provide the vast majority of the care. So if you could explain to him, right, so he can learn, that would be great. Yeah? Is that okay with you?
Yes.
You know, so if you could work with Dr. Ratta,
that's right? Yes.
He speaks English a little better than Dr. Money, and he talks a bit more. So it'd be easier for you to learn, right?
Yes.
Okay, Ratta?
Yeah, all right.
Then they get training either from me, who's here all the time, or the foreigners who come in and who visit, and they will give you 2 weeks of their time and effort and show you how to do some things, and then gradually the Khmer's learn to do it, and then it becomes available in Khmer society without the foreigners. Oh, it's been an extraordinary change here in Cambodia. Yes, absolutely extraordinary. I mean, the way that when I came, there were no working traffic lights. There were some white Land Cruisers belonging to the UN. And apart from that, a few little old Russian vehicles. And then everybody was walking or at the most had a bicycle.
Just as Cambodia has developed, the medical services available here are undergoing dramatic change.
Can Knong now, now and now.
No, block.
Okay, some, yeah. Okay, I could.
Today, Golagly goes to a modern cardiology centre to check on the progress of a young patient. Until a few years ago, such facilities were unheard of in a country whose medical system was shattered during the decades of civil war. When Golagly first arrived, the medicine he found being practiced came straight out of the history books.
Right, but to have a centre like this where they can do open heart operations, and it looks as clean as it does and everything looks good. That's a real achievement here. You know, 1992, that was incomprehensible. I mean, the surgery was sort of like about the time of the American Civil War when you got your leg cut off if you had an open fracture of the tibia. That's what was happening here. But since that time, I mean, you know, it's now 16 years on, it's sort of moved forward to sort of time at more or less the end of the Second World War. From the Civil War to the Second World War, they've done in 10, 15 years what took about 100 years in America, right, as they moved on, right.
In rebuilding the system, expertise from overseas plays a vital role.
Le tissu pour faire l'anapal.
Golagly is on his way back to the operating room, taking with him a visiting colleague from France. The case that awaits them is particularly harrowing, even by Cambodian standards. Miak Lam is a farm worker who's lucky to be alive.
So today we have here Dr. Philippe Michaud, Professor Philippe Michaud from the University of Toulouse, who comes to Cambodia twice a year. And he's a plastic surgeon, burn surgeon, so he's very experienced. So he has been helping us with this lady since we started. So this is a lady who's only 26, who 2 years ago had a fight with some sort of rice threshing machine, and she came off the worst. So she went to the hospital where they fixed up her arms and her legs, the wounds on her arms and legs, and did a little bit to her head, but the machine tore off all her hair and her scalp, and she lost her right eye. And so she's been in the village in this circumstance for about 2 years with no cover, no skin on her head. And she was seen there by an NGO who looked at her and said, this lady looks terrible, and called us up and asked us if we could do something. So we said, yes, bring her in and let's have a look. And we're gradually dressing these wounds of the head, trying to feed her up so she'll heal something, and then we'll do a skin graft. Now, it may take us a week or two before we can do the skin graft and before we get this all off, but if we hadn't done that, she almost certainly would have died. Okay, just go slowly, guys. Start taking it off here. No, let. Right, because she was gradually getting weaker and weaker and losing fluid and protein from this. Blood and pus, yes I know. Okay, well, just go slowly, you know. What do you want us to do? What we're putting on is flamazine, which is silver sulfadiazine. Okay. It sort of has an antibacterial ointment. No, let me just do this one. Okay. Very good, Sokling. I know it's hard work, right? Very good. Do you want another one, Philippe? Yeah. All right.
Il faut coucher sur le ventre.
Yeah. Okay.
On va charger là. Coucher sur le ventre.
Right.
Sinon, jamais.
Okay. Sopostom? Listen. She's laying on her back too much, like that. Eh? Can you undo, Philippe? Tick, tick. Oh, good.
Now, a day after his operation, Nong Sakna is recovering well. He's getting used to life without the huge tumours on his shoulder with which he grew up.
So, we did this guy yesterday, and he's doing okay. He doesn't have very much pain as long as we don't move his shoulder. But I'm a little concerned still about the nerve function. He says he can feel, so that's good. But he doesn't feel the same as on the other side. So we may have stretched that nerve, whatever we did. We've got away without any major damage. And then we've removed his big tumours. And he's got some sensation, so it looks good. Right.
Hearing about the centre, normally by word of mouth, patients travel into Phnom Penh from all parts of Cambodia, often with horrific conditions, in search of a cure. Golagly is helped by his wife, Kanya Reyenbeck, a Thai accountant whom he married after starting up the centre.
Oh, well, basically, Kanya's my wife. She came along, started working for us as a volunteer. I was divorced. I subsequently married her.
It is the typical story, Rob. This is the guy that went into the government hospital and then pay as much as he could and then spend all the money. Uh-huh. And then right now, no money. The hospital doesn't want to keep them. So kick them out. You go wherever.
Kanya has a particularly important job today, caring for 20-year-old Long Pross, about to undergo an operation to implant an artificial eye. Long Pross is a victim of sexual slavery, who is disfigured by her pimp.
This is the girl over there. She's sitting there, and then this is the collection of our artificial eyes that we are going to put on her today. I work with my doctor, and I pick the color.
You've got a circle coming through.
I pick these two. It looks similar as her eye color that we're going to try to put on her eyes today.
This is the standard artificial eye. You may need to have one of the visiting eye guys from America or something. Get a made to match eye, right? Because you've still got quite a bit of defect up here. But this will typically be, to me, two or three operations to get it right, to get the best result.
She's sort of a little bit scary, but she wants to do it. She doesn't think anything too much right now. She just focused on her surgery. She said that she likes to see, to look normal, let's say. Don't cry like a baby.
Performing the operation will be Dr. Sung Soryu.
It looks a lot better.
Yeah,
it looks a lot better. When we put the artificial eye in there.
This girl was kidnapped as a child and then sold into sexual slavery and worked as a prostitute for about 7 years. And then one day her pimp stuck her in the eye with an iron spike and infected all her eye. That was in 2006. And she was still made to work after that, but about a month later it was all pussed out and nobody wanted her, so she was then thrown out of the brothel, went to another eye hospital, Takeo Eye Hospital, where they took the eye out and treated her for the infection. They didn't have artificial eyes, so, and they don't do reconstructions too much, so they sent her here. So we operated on her in October and put a false eye in, but the socket was so deficient and there was so much space that the eye fell back too far. So in December, we put in a graft from her scalp. It's gone into the back of the eye to fill up the orbit. And now we put the eye in again and are trying to make it look a lot better. So it will look better after this, but we'll probably have to do it once or twice more to get a really good result, right? We'll have to trim it a bit, let the tissue shrink a bit, see what happens. And get all done. So it'll be 6 to 9 months before we've really finished. And by that time, she should look pretty good. The eye won't move, but it'll be the same color as the other side. It'll look normal when she looks straight ahead.
Evening at home in the Gologly house. Kanya and Jim watch their daughter Uma's first steps.
You're going to walk to daddy?
Yeah.
Can you walk to daddy? Oh, no, not too fast. No. Just go there. Stand there, me and mommy. Okay.
Back at the surgical center, is Gologly's son from a previous marriage.
Yeah.
Sohrab is also an orthopedic surgeon. He takes a break from his private practice in Monterey, California, each year to help with his father's mission.
And
Sohrab basically went to school in the States, having been born in England, and is an orthopedic surgeon and specializes in spines and hip replacements, redo hips as they call it in the business, and works in Monterey, California, and comes over here once a year.
It's all just necrotic and gone.
You couldn't find two different practices than my practice back home and private practice in Monterey, California, my experience of coming to Cambodia. Back home, I see patients in clinic 3 days a week. I operate 2 days a week. I operate in the crown jewel of hospitals in California, which is an absolutely beautiful, you know, $100-couple hundred million facility with views over the ocean and from our operating rooms. It's clean, it's white, it's sterile. There are very, very nice cars in the garage, and people have extraordinarily high expectations. Here it's completely different. We're operating with operations going on at the same time in an operating room. All of the equipment here is kludged together. It's begged, borrowed, and stolen from various different sources all around the world. And the patients that we see come here from all over Cambodia, largely by word of mouth, with some of the most horrendous diseases that you can imagine. I always tell people that the greatest thing about going to Cambodia is the first thing that you can get out of your medical vocabulary is the question, what brings you to the doctor's office today? because if it's not readily apparent by the time it walks in the clinic, it's rare that it's something that we're going to treat over here. And then the other thing is that as you've noticed by being here, you know, you can see some of the most horrendous aspects of disease here in Cambodia. I mean, sometimes clinic and at Children's Surgical Center, it's a little bit like the bar scene in the Star Wars movie. I mean, there are things that you just simply don't typically see. And so I really enjoy coming every year. It's a difficult trip. I always go home pretty worn out and exhausted. It's emotionally challenging, and the surgery itself is very, very difficult here. But it's been rewarding to see the progression of skills in the institution over time.
In the consulting room, their collective expertise is needed in the case of 9-year-old Mun Chan Wiesner.
Where's he been getting treated? Who's been giving him the braces?
In Prey Veng.
He was born with severe VI deformities of both feet and one hand. The team must weigh up their options.
Okay, this hand is good. Does he go to school?
Yeah,
Tanaktiman.
Maybe I'll get something out of that, huh?
Yeah, I think you can do that. But, you know, let's leave that for the hand guys. Yeah. Right, we'll find a hand guy for that. Let's do these things. We'll never get a foot guy. Right, we've got to do this ourselves. Show us your hand, Twinny. Right, okay.
Given the challenge of operating on such rare deformities, the boy's case is the kind that attracts interest from overseas specialists.
Right. Okay. He's got two, right, metatarsals, and the toe is biffin.
Details of his deformities are compiled in the hope that an overseas hospital will take on his case. Sohrab Gologli's specialization is spinal surgery, and several cases have been awaiting his visit. Among them is Teng Navi, a 13-year-old girl suffering from scoliosis, or curvature of the spine.
Three spines.
New spine.
Three new spines. Where are they? Three new spines?
Yeah.
Right. Okay, come on in.
Yeah, so this is a, you know, a 13-year-old girl with scoliosis. Looks like she's got a little hemivertebra here.
1996, yeah.
Measuring the curve with a technique called the Cobb method. And then she also has this really bad curve like this.
So, come here.
13-year-old female, 42 degrees scoliosis.
Assisting in the operation will be Dr. Ucheng Nyep, the most senior of the center's Cambodian surgeons.
When she goes to school, usually she was teased by her friend about her spine that's abnormal, it's curved. So that now she wants to have her spine straight like the other kid. That's why she wanted to have the operation.
So Niep is more or less my right hand. I would say he's one of the best surgeons I've ever met in my life. Not just Cambodia, ever. A guy who can come up, look at the new problem, is willing to take it on, learns how to deal with it, and can think straight within the parameters of that problem.
But Dr. Nyep wasn't always going to be a doctor. He'd wanted to be an engineer, but the Khmer Rouge changed all that.
What made you want to be a doctor?
I say at the time it was my father's death during the Khmer Rouge. I had wanted to be an engineer, but then I switched to be a medical doctor.
Just outside Phnom Penh, Cambodia's notorious killing fields, the site where thousands of victims of the Khmer Rouge lost their lives. Across Cambodia, it's estimated the genocide killed 2 million people. Anyone considered part of the educated elite was especially at risk, including the country's doctors.
I think before the Khmer Rouge, we have several hundred doctors. And then when the Khmer Rouge came to power, then all the doctors, all the officers, all everybody had to leave the town to go to work on the rice field and so on. And there are some or most of them get killed or were starved to death, something like that, got a lot of torture. Then after the Khmer Rouge, I think only very few doctors come back alive.
The one I saw you yesterday with, and I said you can do the osteochondromas.
Still trying to rebuild the medical system, Cambodia remains heavily dependent on foreign help. But Dr. Ngyep knows that one day they must become self-reliant.
I fully agree with the idea that the Cambodian doctor must not rely too much on the foreign doctors, because this is Cambodian, this is our country, so we should build our country by ourselves.
So if you figured out that it's going to
with that foreign help comes something of a culture clash, especially in the form of Dr. Jim Gollagly.
Possibility or not? Why don't you just say to me, okay, we thought about that, it ain't going to work, right?
Hailing from an old school medical tradition, his abrasive style is sometimes at odds with the younger generation and often at odds with the softly spoken ways of the Cambodians.
Yeah, we need to find out what's wrong with
something
that kid.
Acute,
right,
yeah.
Right, right. What's the matter with him? Do you know?
Broken leg.
A broken leg? Yeah. Well, it doesn't wait for Dr. Nia. Bring him in now. Let me have a look at the x-ray. Has he got an x-ray?
I look at my dad and I have an incredible amount of admiration for him.
Broken leg?
Why's your skull shot?
I think that there are few people that could accomplish this, and I think that there are undeniable personality traits that some people would call dictatorial, some people would call bulldozer-like, that allow someone to come to a country like this and build a hospital up to the point where it does 4,000 operations a year.
So, Clay, cut it out. I did this whole operation without an IV. I don't want an IV now. Oh, hemograph. Why can't you stick it in the groin? I mean, you know, it's just awful. I mean, you know, you can basically take some blood right here, no problem, right? Okay. You know, whether I'm an explosive Irishman or whatever. if I say things nice and quietly, they don't always react. They don't always quite understand, and they don't understand it's a request or an order or anything like that.
Also, there's a generational thing. You know, as medicine has evolved, it used to be very common for people in the first world to have personalities like my dad. There used to be a lot more screaming and shouting. There used to be a lot more thrown instruments in the operating room. It used to be acceptable to kind of lose your temper. And now, of course, that's not the case anymore. I mean, we live in an environment where we're really good at what we do. We basically are following a flight plan. The expectation is that we're calm and, you know, polite to everybody. And if not, we end up probably in some sexual harassment committee somewhere explaining our behavior to somebody else.
Me, when I started to know him, it became to me very strange when he shout, when he scream. But now I used to him, I know that he's kind man.
Your fingers out. You take this finger off now. You don't need these fingers. You don't need these fingers now. In Cambodia, because of the language problem, they're paying attention more to the tone than to what the words are. Very good, Sok Lang. Very good. Good. Got a name on and everything?
Yeah.
So I've got to change the tone depending on what I want done. And if I want something done and I just say it nice and calmly, can we transfer this patient over there and let me know when it's done? It's just a conversation. They're not paying very much attention. But if I say, now transfer that patient over there and call me when it's finished, then it's far more likely to get done. And then I'll be less frustrated.
Recurve seen from the front of the spine.
So Rob is quiet and very friendly. He will not shout, he's more patient. But Jim is this is a bit of difference between the father and the son.
It's with the son that Dr. Nyep will be working as Teng Navi is prepared for her back operation.
So the way this will work is Nyep will do it. I do one half and then Nyep does the other half. And in the process, get the operation done. So we'll give her a general anesthetic. She'll lie face down on the operating room table. It'll be a large incision. And then we're using older generation spinal instrumentation here. We have kind of a hodgepodge of different forms of instrumentation that that have been available to us that we've scavenged over the years from various different hospitals and donations. And so we'll hook that up with two stainless steel instrumentation rods and place something that we call sublaminar wires underneath a portion of the spine and try to correct the spine as much as possible given the limits of the instrumentation that we have, and also the fact that this isn't really the most ideal setting in the world to do really, really aggressive correction. And you know, if this was done back home in the United States, we'd have a neurologist monitoring spinal cord function. And the thing that we worry the most about is someone who has a cosmetic deformity of the spine that we know that's going to get worse over many years, has a spinal operation and wakes up paraplegic.
So this is an example of how rare this case would be in the United States. Over a 25-year period, I think there are maybe 15 or 20 cases. I don't know that it's any more prevalent than it is in the United States. It's just that this is the only institution in the entire country of 12 million people that's at least gonna, you know, look at these and do it. So every time I come here, I'm always amazed by the frequency of really severe spinal cases. On the other hand, you know, the vast majority of what I do back home in the United States is back pain, and we don't see that here. I'm sure they have back pain in Cambodia, but it doesn't come to the clinic.
Okay, so we're trying to organize this operation, and the basic deal is we may not need a blood transfusion, but we may. And we don't want to run into problems where we have no blood if we really need it. We've sent the patient with our laboratory technician over to the blood bank, and the patient and her father went over there. And normally they want, for every unit they're going to give you, they want a donation of a unit. So her father has gone over there and donated a unit of blood, and we now have one unit of blood, right? But we want two, right? So their story, the blood bank story is, maybe they can give us another one at 5 o'clock. Well, that may actually be not too bad for us, but we'd like it before that. So what will probably happen is if I've got a minute, I'll run over this afternoon and give a unit of blood, and then we'll have the two units. It won't be a problem.
You're old. Huh? You're old.
No.
Help it. Yeah. Mine's not working.
And the big difficulty is having the blood when you need it, not waiting till 5 o'clock or waiting till whatever. If I go and I give him a unit now, we'll be one unit up. We might be able to get three for this lady if we need it. But we're sure to need it tomorrow or the day after, right? So usually what I do is when we have some big surgery like this, I get all the foreigners to go and give some blood so that we're sort of ahead of the game. And then if we need one urgently, the blood bank will maybe give it to us. It's a sort of little game we play.
Can you open the tray of all the spinal stuff? These are called Harrington rods, so these are the original rods that we use to treat scoliosis. And it's a medical grade stainless steel, and it's a really stiff alloy, and it's difficult to work with, and but it's here.
When I do this operation at home with all the toys I have at home, I have titanium alloys, I have intraoperative x-ray, I have 1,000 things that make that technical operation so much easier in my hands at home. Here, typically the deformities are bigger, the patients are smaller, the instrumentation is clumsier. It's something that we were using in the United States 20 or 30 years ago, and the entire process is difficult.
Yeah. After a promising start, they run into trouble. One of the hooks needed to anchor the rod into position keeps coming free from the spine.
Is it, did we break it?
Probably should have a better rod because we have a problem to fix the upper hook.
Can you still get underneath there?
Each time we try to put the rod in, and the rod just split out the bone.
Yeah. Grab the end of this one here.
The team now has the units of blood to complete the operation, but the problem of anchoring the rod puts the whole process in doubt.
It's useless using this stuff. It really is. It's too. It's
way too stiff for a kid this size.
Yeah.
It's way too big. It's the wrong stuff.
And it gets the top hook to go to the top.
Yeah.
The hook fails to take again.
Okay. Well, the other alternative is if they won't hook, right, is that we cue that and put it in a gap.
Yeah, I know that.
I don't have much confidence that it's going to work until the last moment that we try to put the hook under.
They persevere, and finally the rod is secured in place. The operation is a success.
I always have heartburn in these cases until they actually wake up and wiggle their toes.
Early morning in downtown Phnom Penh. And the working day has already begun for Dr. Nyep at his desk, quietly writing his thesis.
This is a thesis on meningoid carpalocele that I operated on Children's Surgical Center.
The condition is a meningoid carpalocele. It's an outpouching of the lining of the brain, the fluid around the brain, and some brain itself coming through a hole in the skull and coming out through the forehead onto the face.
It's a birth defect thought to be produced by mothers eating moldy rice during pregnancy and found throughout Southeast Asia. Allowed to go untreated, it seems to be fatal with no one yet surviving into adulthood. Dr. Nyep has probably had more experience of operating on the condition than any other Cambodian doctor.
It's not in Cambodia, but all the whole Southeast Asia. Yeah. It's very common in Thailand, in Burma, in Malaysia, in Cambodia. We've done 162 cases already.
Yeah, Niab's the world's expert on this condition.
Cambodian expert.
Cambodian expert.
So we think that this is found in rice farmers. It's sporadic. People grow rice, they store it. In the rainy season, the rice can get moldy. A mold produces a toxin that interferes with folic acid. If the mother is pregnant 6 to 8 weeks when she eats the moldy rice and gets a dose of the toxin, it interferes with the baby closing off what's called the neural tube at the top end. So this is quite common.
Despite its prevalence, relatively little work has so far been done on it because it largely affects the poorer sections of the community.
Yeah, basically this is poor people out in the countryside, but in the towns, people would probably just be buying rice from the shop. The rice would not get moldy, otherwise people wouldn't buy it, so they don't get the condition.
It illustrates one of the inherent inequalities in the Cambodian system, where medical resources are often directed towards those sections of the society that have the ability to pay.
Oftentimes the people who would be the best physicians are not the people who are moving through the medical school system. Then once they get out, they need to be able to make a living. And oftentimes the people who can afford to pay are the people who have less and less wrong with them. And so what you see in a lot of these third world countries is that a lot of people who actually do have talent and are licensed by the government to practice medicine end up running rinky-dink family practice units where they see a lot of patients and they basically run a pharmacy and they provide a lot of pills for people. And so my understanding is that's very, very common here, that a lot of people will graduate from the medical school system here, and what they'll do is they'll go into private practice where essentially they're running a pharmacy. They'll see the worried well of Cambodia and they'll give them pills. And oftentimes they don't have the resources that surround them to be able to make use of their talents to become surgeons or to do particularly difficult things.
Come on, buddy, you and me.
Thankfully, Dr. Nyep finds himself in the kind of environment where he can become the surgeon he aspires to be. Now an expert in meningoencephalocele, he's also becoming proficient in scoliosis.
Hold the big toe up towards your head.
Together with Sohrab Gologli, a look in on their scoliosis patient, Nabi.
Up that way.
Just one day after her surgery and getting ready to walk again.
Bend her
a lot straighter than she walked the day before.
Back bound, eh?
And she can feel everything normally?
Another successful step along the road of transferring expertise from visiting Westerners to their Khmer counterparts.
You know, medical care in a country like this is challenging. I mean, it's hot and it's sweaty and the air conditioning doesn't work and things smell and people have horrible diseases. And these are really challenging things to treat even when you're first world trained. And I think they can be absolutely overwhelming when you're third world trained.
Does she feel like standing up?
And so when you come to a place like this, for me, it's the best and the most difficult cases of the year that I see here. For a Cambodian, they don't feel that. This is just more horrible stuff they've got to deal with on a daily basis.
Okay, come on, sweetie, let's swing your legs over.
And so sometimes you have to kind of catch yourself that the enthusiasm that I feel for coming here and the complexity of the cases may not be shared by the Cambodians that I'm working with, because they're surrounded by this disease and disability all the time, and what might make them really excited is someone who's actually a lot better that they can really feel like they can have a positive impact upon.
She should be getting up twice a day.
Twice a day, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
It seems so much better for her in terms of her pulmonary function and
yeah.
and everything else. Okay. And obviously her pain control is good enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
That good result?
Yeah, terrific. Terrific.
Nong Sakna made a full recovery from his operation to remove his shoulder tumors and returned home.
After he'd been home and he came back and he took out the sutures and he was much happier and everything looked good, we saw him about a month later after that and he was still happy and everything was going great, and we haven't seen him since. We usually presume that means that everything's going very well, right? That he doesn't see the necessity to waste money to come back to see us.
Miak Lam, who was injured in the rice threshing accident, also made a full recovery, but her story took a tragic turn.
She made a complete recovery, as far as we were concerned. She stayed with us for 2 to 3 months until we had 95% of her scalp healed. She decided to go home before we'd completely finished up and got it all healed.
She returned to her home but died unexpectedly from a stomach ailment completely unrelated to her injuries.
It's one of the things that happens. You spend all this time looking after somebody and they go home and something else happens which is relatively minor and there's a death from it.
This morning.
Long Pross is still undergoing reconstructive surgery to give her a false eye and give her back her looks.
On the superior and inferior folic.
So they haven't signed on the dotted line that they're going to do it yet, but they've looked at his legs.
For 9-year-old Visna, the news was promising. The Hospital for Sick Children in Toronto, Canada, had expressed an interest in taking on his case.
Oh, they'll have seen something like this, but only occasionally. You know, if you've been going for 30 years, that's who the sort of doctor is going to be seeing. Right, they've seen this in Africa or somewhere like that, but they don't get it every day in Toronto.
A few weeks after this checkup, he was on a plane for Canada, where he underwent a series of operations on his feet and hands. He's now back in Cambodia, living happily with his family. 2 months after her scoliosis operation, Teng Navi is returning to the centre for a follow-up.
Here she is. Hello, Navi. Some going out in here.
She's now able to lead a normal life in her home village.
Okay,
she said that it's easy for lie down, and then also she got more.
And she's taller.
Yeah.
But what about the other kids in the village? Have they made any difference? Did they used to call her names before?
She's scared, she doesn't like to go out because
back
is very bad, but right now she's looked a lot better, so she stopped scaring and then can go out and play with the
other kids.
As she returns to that new life, so Dr. Jim Gologly too returns to his whiteboard and the cases coming up for tomorrow.
So you see there's 8 patients on, which is a bit much for a Friday, but we have to do those 2 babies first. There's a 7-month-old with a complete cleft lip on the left, and there's an 8-month-old with a unilateral.